So this comic, which I had up at the beginning of class, or yeah, the beginning of class, last class period, is sort of a play on personal genomics and the fact that it is actually now quite quite inexpensive. So services like 23andMe will look at known variations that can either help trace ancestry or have disease relevance. And then give you all of that information about what different variants you have. And that costs $100 to do. Nowadays, it costs maybe $500 to $1,000 if you want your entire genome sequence. There aren't as many commercial operations to do that, but those probably in the next 5 or 10 years will become more and more common. It used to be that with 23andMe, they would give you not only you have X variant of this gene and you have X variant of that gene and so on and so forth, which they still do. But they used to also say, and this variant is linked to such and such things. And so, you know, like this variant is more common among blue-eyed people than brown-eyed people, or this variant is more common among people whose ancestry traces back to Ireland versus England or whatever. They still give you the ancestry information, but the health-related stuff they've stopped giving. And the reason that they've stopped giving the health information is because decontextualized, it can be misleading. And in fact, people have inherent biases toward new information in a way that can actually be detrimental to their health. And so, for example, if I get back my 23andMe results, and my 23andMe results say that my risk of heart disease and cancer, which are the two leading causes of death in the United States, collectively accounting for about half of all the deaths in the US, so it tells me heart disease and cancer, my risk is cut in half. I'll be like, great, okay, I'll take up smoking and don't exercise, none of that, don't have to worry about it. And then I learn that my risk of chronic liver disease has doubled. Then I'm like, all right, I'll take up smoking and never touch alcohol again. And that would be a terrible decision because, well, maybe now my risk of chronic liver disease has doubled, and that sounds bad, right? And it certainly is not. I mean, I may want to moderate alcohol consumption because of that. But nonetheless, the baseline chance in the general population, 1.3% of people die from liver disease. If my risk is doubled from because of my genetics, then I've got a 2.5% chance of dying from liver disease. Whereas if my risk of heart disease and cancer are cut in half, then collectively, instead of being 50% of the chance of me dying, now they amount to 25% of the chance of me dying. So I should still be worried about heart disease and cancer. And I should still be doing all of those things that doctors tell everybody to do in terms of exercise and good health and whatever other preventative measures are needed to help protect against those things that kill collectively more people than anything else. And so lulling people into a false sense of security by saying their risk of heart disease is reduced can be detrimental because it can change people's behavior in a way that then makes them actually more at risk of heart disease. And so that's one of the reasons why 23andMe has been discouraged from providing those pieces of information. Although you can still get them through third-party suppliers if you've got your raw data that they give you. And so today we're going to sort of continue and finish up our discussion of cancer. Depending on time, we may be able to get into a little bit of stuff in terms of basic cell structure, which is going to be the main focus for next week. But before we go on into that, I wanted to return to a little bit of this idea of cancer as something that evolves in your body. So, mutations happen, I'm 10 trillion cells, many of which are dividing, and I'm not getting bigger most of the time, unless I slow down and start eating a lot of chocolate and whatever, then parts of me might start to get bigger. But generally speaking, I've sort of reached a size that I'm kind of staying at. And so cells are dying and cells are also dividing. And every once in a while, a cell of mine divides and has a mutation. Maybe even, and many, many of those mutations are harmless. Almost as many are probably going to, if anything, just hurt the cell and it will die naturally because of those mutations. But every once in a while, it's in one of these tumor suppressor genes or proto-oncogenes, and that will put that cell at risk of becoming a cancer cell. And most of the time, cells will catch the fact that they have these sorts of mutations and will undergo apoptosis, the cellular suicide. Or if they don't catch it, then my immune system will catch it and kill them. But every once in a while, one manages to have the right set of mutations, and there are a lot of different right sets of mutations in this respect, where that cell will now not die, but instead begin to proliferate. And again, as it proliferates, many, many of its daughter cells will just remain exactly like it and maybe be growing a little bit faster, might turn into a little bump or benign polyp on, so this is in the colon, might turn into a little bump or benign polyp. And not necessarily anything to worry about. But if it's dividing fast enough, a lot of its cells are just by chance going to pick up their own mutations. In part because enough cell division and mutations happen, but in part also because the nature of the mutation that started this polyp growing is one that means that the cell is paying less attention for future mutations. It's not having the same sort of checks on its own cell division that normal cells do. And so many, many, many of its daughter cells are going to pick up mutations that are meaningless. A large fraction of its daughter cells are going to pick up mutations that are harmful and they will die. But maybe one of its daughter cells picks up a mutation that affects a tumor suppressor gene. And now that one starts dividing even faster than all of the rest of this little polyp. And so now I've got a polyp that's growing much faster. It's still relatively benign. But it's now, because it's dividing faster and faster, a lot of more cells are coming out. Many of them pick up mutations that are useless. Many of them pick up mutations that kill them. But a couple pick up mutations that speed up their division even further by mutating maybe another tumor suppressor gene or another proto-oncogene. And so you end up then with something that's growing even faster. And after a few weeks, the majority of this lump is now made up of these fastest growing cells. And it's sort of evolution taking place in your body. And these fast-growing cells, if they pick up enough mutations, will now be able to exit the tissue that they began in and get into the blood and set up colonies, which we call metastatic neoplasms, that are new tumors that form in other tissues. And that can become extremely life-threatening because now you have a lot of little tumors all over your body that are out-competing and harming many of your organs. And that is why cancer can and is quite deadly. So I guess, what questions do people have about that idea, that sort of idea of evolution of a tumor in your body, before we go on to other related topics? So backing up here, I was sort of hard a little bit on personal genomics before, and there are quite legitimate criticisms to be made of personal genomics. But one area in which personal genomics has already been very, very helpful for a lot of patients, and as we're going to talk about today, there are some new treatments involving targeted immunotherapy, which is going to be the focus of today, that take personal genomics to sort of the next level and really make for a promising but extremely expensive way to treat cancers. So if I have a tumor that develops in my body, that tumor cell picks up mutations in several different proto-oncogenes and several different tumor suppressor genes. But it's somewhat random. I mean, there's a sort of collection that is going to help it evolve more quickly and help it grow more quickly. But my tumor might have a mutation in P53 or it might not. My tumor might have a mutation in a cyclin gene that turns up its production or it might not. And so my tumor is going to grow differently depending on which mutations it has in it. And one of the ways that we are making a lot of advances in treating cancer right now is studying how, first of all, taking samples of tumors from cancer patients and identifying what genes are mutated in that cancer compared to the rest of the person's body. Then seeing how they respond to different treatments and using what we learned from the first round of patients to inform our treatments of future patients. And so we're learning, for example, that some types of chemotherapy drugs are effective against cancers that have P53 as mutation, other types are not, and some types are effective against cancers that have RAS as a mutation, other types are not. And so by seeing the collection of mutations that are present in a person's tumor, you are able to personalize their chemotherapy and other treatments to their cancer. If I were unlucky enough to develop two tumors simultaneously in different parts of my body, even in like, so let's say I had two spots in my liver that both simultaneously developed, liver's on the right side, two spots in my liver that both simultaneously developed tumors, those two tumors would be different from each other. But if I only have one tumor in my liver and then it starts metastasizing to other parts of my liver and to other parts of my body, then it's going to be pretty similar throughout my whole body. And so the cancer isn't just a function of you, it's also a function of sort of the random mutations that happened and the particular history of that cancer as it evolved in your body. And so different tumors that evolve separately in your body may differ from one another, but different tumors that come from a common source metastatic deposits of the same cancer cells into other parts will be similar because they're related to each other. And so that is sort of the first idea in targeted personalized medicine for cancer, is to identify what is different between your cancer and you, the rest of your body, the healthy cells that didn't turn into cancerous cells. And these can be changes in cancer-related genes, like tumor suppressor genes, which, remember, tumor suppressor gene is something like RAS or like P53 or XPA that either shuts down cell division in response to a signal, or which is what RAS does, or will search for damage to DNA and prevent further mutations like P53 and XPA do. So there could be some tumor suppressors that are uniquely different. There could be some proto-oncogenes that mutated into oncogenes. And so like cyclins that are normally only on in certain phases of the cell cycle and promote the cell's movement in through certain phases of the cell cycle, if they become on all the time, then the cell is going to be always getting the signal to divide instead of just sometimes getting a signal to divide. So proto-oncogenes are something that do their own job. They don't exist for the purpose of suppressing tumors. They exist for the purpose of doing something else. But if you tweak them, then cell division can grow out of control. So those are some differences. And in addition to that, we've talked a little bit about surface proteins on cells and how that distinguishes cells from each other. And that's how your immune system can identify if cells are not where they belong or if cells are external invaders, or if cells are otherwise in the wrong place or behaving unusually. And so these surface proteins, some of them actually do relate to the cancer itself and its evolution, because some of them can be receptors that sense these social signals that inhibit cell division. But others of them, just because these cells are starting to divide so fast, they're going to start making mistakes and having mutations in genes that have nothing to do with them becoming cancerous. And nonetheless, you will have some errors and some misfoldings and some differences in the surface proteins on your tumor cells as compared to the healthy cells in your body. And that can be another clue that your immune system can use to identify that this cell is no longer a healthy part of the body here. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? Sort of the idea of personalized medicine meets cancer here.
So how much faster is the tumor cell dividing such that you can get that many more mutations to detect?
I mean, cancer cells can go through mitosis instead of every 24 hours, which is actually on the high end for a cell in your body. The median cell in your body is probably dividing once every week or so. But a cancer cell can be dividing every 6 hours or something as it gets faster and faster. It depends on the type of cancer, where it originates, and a lot of other factors. But it's really just limited by DNA replication. And as fast as they can replicate the DNA, that's how fast they're dividing. They're kind of doing nothing else, or just enough to stay alive. And a lot of the cancer cells die because they're just dividing so much that they sacrifice sometimes even their own ability to keep themselves alive. But enough of them are being made that some of them do manage to survive. Okay, and so kind of moving to a side point here, and then we'll come back to it. We've mentioned a little bit about viruses once or twice in the class, but actually this question here is one that's not one that you're going to have to really think about so much. But there are a variety of different viruses. There's a huge sort of taxonomy of viruses. Some viruses have DNA. Some viruses use RNA as their genetic material. This is a phage, which is a virus that infects bacteria. And some viruses will incorporate their DNA into the nucleus and into the chromosomes in your cells when you get infected. Others will just put their genetic material loose in the cell and count on some of your cell's machinery to mistakenly convert that into protein. But one particular type of virus that I wanted to talk a little bit about is HIV and retroviruses in general. So HIV is a type of retrovirus. And what a retrovirus, the name retrovirus comes from, so we've sort of mentioned this a little bit and we'll come back to it more later, but DNA will code for by coding for it will help you produce a new RNA, and then that RNA gets taken out of the nucleus and that can be used as instructions for building a protein. What a retrovirus does is it does it sort of backwards. So retroviruses, their genome is RNA. And then they have in that genome a gene that codes for something called reverse transcriptase. So the proteins on the outside of the virus recognize the specific cell that they're going to infect. In the case of HIV, it's going to be T cells in the immune system. What you're going to do what is going to happen with an HIV infection is the HIV virus particles get into your blood, and then once the HIV virus particles are in your blood, they find and attach to T cells. Then they insert their RNA into T cells. And it codes for reverse transcriptase, which is going to turn the RNA into DNA. And then in addition to that, the RNA codes for another enzyme called integrase, which carries this DNA into the nucleus of the T cell. And in the case of an HIV infection, then what's going to happen is that the rest of that DNA is going to instruct the T cell to stop being a T cell and working as an immune cell, and instead just start making more HIV. And so then this reprograms the T cell to be an HIV factory. And having that happen to one T cell is sort of unfortunate, but then that one T cell becomes an HIV factory, makes 10,000 more HIV virus particles, those get out and infect 10,000 more T cells, and then each one of them becomes an HIV factory and creates itself 10,000 more, and now you're up to several million HIV particles in your blood. And then a few days later, those T cells have all popped open and released 10,000 more HIV particles each into your blood, and now a large fraction of your T cells are no longer being T cells and fighting invaders. Instead, they are HIV factories. And so that becomes a problem because your T cells, you need your T cells to fight off invaders, and your immune system becomes compromised because all your T cells have been reprogrammed into being HIV factories instead of into fighting off invaders.
Before the viral genomic RNA gets injected into the nucleus, mm-hmm. how is it getting transcribed?
Yeah, so the RNA gets injected into the cytoplasm, and then there the ribosome, which is the structure that takes RNA and copies it into protein, says, oh, RNA, I know what to do with RNA. I grab a hold of it and I make proteins off of it. And so it grabs a hold of the RNA and makes a protein. And it happens that protein is reverse transcriptase and integrase. And so then the reverse transcriptase that the ribosome just made thinking it was supposed to, but really it was the virus that wanted it to do it and not you, now that reverse transcriptase takes that same RNA and turns it into double-stranded DNA, and then the integrase says, oh, okay, I know what to do with that double-stranded DNA, and comes and brings it into the nucleus, and then breaks one of your chromosomes at a random spot and inserts the whole HIV genome, now as DNA, into the middle of one of your chromosomes. And then that starts a sort of set of instructions off that will tell the T cell that its primary job now is to just do that. And so the HIV genome has a few more genes than I talked about, but components of the outside, components to get it into, and then also a variety of other genes here, and the details of which are not so critical as just sort of understanding these steps. But collectively, it does reprogram the T cell into being an HIV factory.
Why would you need to go through the trouble of becoming DNA when you can just code out proteins straight from the RNA?
Some viruses do that. Some viruses don't. I don't know. There's a lot of different solutions to the problem of getting yourself replicated, and this is the one that some viruses have figured out that works well enough. Yeah. What other questions do people have about that? Yeah, sure.
Do cells within retroviruses, are they able to communicate with one another? Or not cells, but, you know, like units. Are they able to communicate with one another? Because I imagine if they mutate so quickly, they, you know, it would be difficult for them to.
So if I have an active HIV infection in my blood, you're asking, do the different HIV virus particles in my blood communicate with one another? Is that the question? As far as I know, they don't. Viruses are really simple and don't really have the capacity to do that. But there can be an evolutionary process of its own that goes on with the virus and the virus infection. If you take one type of antiretroviral medication that knocks down and prevents a lot of the HIV from continuing to infect more and more of your T cells, then it will kill a lot of the HIV virus particles. But because there's so many of them and mistakes happen in DNA replication, a couple of them might be immune to that one antiretroviral that you're taking. And then you have now, you sort of get better, and then those couple that are immune to your antiretroviral start to proliferate more in your body, and now there's a whole lot of antiretroviral immune HIV running around in your body. And so this is similar conceptually to bacteria evolving immunity against evolving resistance to antibiotics. The mechanisms differ to the extent that the bacteria can replicate themselves, whereas viruses need other cells to replicate themselves. But the idea of mutations coming up and changing the way that these things behave can be an issue. And so a lot of people with HIV will take cocktails of multiple different antiretrovirals to try to limit the chances that any of the virus particles are going to be immune to all of the different medications that they're taking simultaneously. And similarly, for severe antibiotic-resistant infections, sometimes you will take multiple different antibiotics at the same time in the hopes of sort of eliminating all of the bacteria and not letting any of the and having it so that the probability of any one being immune to all of the different antibiotics that you're taking being relatively low. Other questions about that? Yeah, sure.
How effective are in the case of HIV, because like the blood, are like interferons just not really as effective?
I think I have to admit ignorance a little bit. I don't remember exactly what interferons do.
When cells and kind of say like I've been infected by a virus to get other cells to kind of be like aware,
I don't remember. So one thing that is kind of related to that is cells sometimes can recognize that they're infected with a virus, and like a macrophage, will put the virus out on, put the little sign out on the side saying, hey, by the way, this is an invader, and oh, also, I'm infected and I need somebody to come over and kill me because I'm a virus factory here and I'm a danger to the rest of the organism. So that happens. And there are a lot of different signals that go on in the immune system. I don't know enough about interferon to answer that question, though. But I suspect that a large number of infected T cells do get caught, but a small number don't, and that's all you need to keep the infection going is probably what goes on. I'll try to look up interferon in particular. It's been too long since I've focused on the immune system. Yeah. Other questions about that? About HIV or any of that? Okay, and so bringing sort of the immune system that we talked about last time together with the ideas of cancer that we've been talking about over the last couple of classes, in 2013 now, so about 3.5 years ago, Science Magazine, which is one of the two preeminent magazines for all science research throughout the world, publish every year their sort of breakthrough of the year. And almost always those breakthroughs are basic science-oriented breakthroughs. Things like, you know, discovery of gravitational waves is a likely candidate for the breakthrough of the year this year. And when it is biology, it might be like understanding something new about the function of the development of bones or something like that. Things that sometimes do have practical applications, but the breakthroughs themselves are typically basic research. But a couple of years ago, they broke with that tradition and focused on cancer immunotherapy as the breakthrough of the year. And there are a couple of short articles that I've posted on Blackboard along with the slides for today, as well as one YouTube video about one of the patients involved that's up with all of the class videos. And I encourage you to read through those and sort of get some more detail about the story. But the basic idea of cancer immune therapy is to take this personal genomics sort of to the next level. And so right now, the more common approach with personal genomics is, okay, we're going to identify what's unique about your cancer, and then we've got a library of histories of various patients, and we know that with these types of cancer, drug X is effective, and with these types of cancers, drug Y is more effective. And so we're going to tailor the drugs that we give you to the unique aspects of your cancer. And it's a little bit expensive. It costs $1,000 to sequence the genome of your tumor and another $1,000 to sequence the genome of your healthy cells. But on the scope of cancer therapy and cancer treatment, that's not too much money. But you know, step one is, for this, just like any other personal genomics, step one is we've got to figure out what distinguishes your tumor from the rest of your body. And so that's one of the things that we do. But then, as this indicates here, what we're going to, the next step of this is to modify your T cells to target and attack specifically your cancer. And this is Carl June. He's one of the lead investigators that's been involved in both the basic science and translational and clinical research in order to figure this out and to get this happening. The reason that this was touted as this major breakthrough in 2013 is because at that point they had six or seven patients, about half of whom had recovered from terminal end-stage leukemia, in which they were predicted, they were given only a few months to live, and then half of them survived, which is not a complete cure, obviously, but is quite a lot better than is expected, given that. And so we've talked a little bit already about surface proteins. But there are a few, so what we're going to do here, so step one, identify what's unique about your tumor. Step two, reprogram your T cells. And in order to reprogram the T cells, what is done is essentially kind of a self bone marrow transplant. So one thing that can be done if I have leukemia is that leukemia is a cancer that forms in the bone marrow and the blood, which blood cells all are born in the bone marrow. And so if I have leukemia, one thing that can be done that's a somewhat dramatic treatment but can be quite effective is to kill all of my bone marrow cells, which would, in short order, result in me dying, except before you do that, you have somebody lined up, maybe a close relative or maybe somebody who's who's just a good Samaritan, who has similar enough genetic and in particular similar enough surface proteins on their healthy cells that my body isn't going to react badly if their cells get put into me. And so you collect some bone marrow from this donor, you kill all of my bone marrow cells, and then you implant the bone marrow from the donor deep into my bones, so that now I have the leukemia-producing bone marrow that I've had is all gone, and I've got healthy bone marrow from a healthy donor. So that's bone marrow transplants, kind of traditional bone marrow transplants. This is a little bit different. This is sort of a self bone marrow transplant. And in this case, we don't actually kill the patient's bone marrow. Instead, what we do is just extract some of it. And then after you extract some of the bone marrow, then you need to reprogram the T cells, or the progenitors of the T cells, the cells that are creating new T cells, to have some modifications to them. And there are two modifications that you need to do. And actually, before I go into those two modifications, let me just pause there. What questions do people have about the idea of bone marrow transplant, in sort of the general sense?
So you need two samples.
The bone marrow is where the T cells are produced. And so you're taking that and reprogramming the stem cells that are making T cells. Yeah. Okay, so there are two modifications that you make to the T cells. Modification number one sort of only makes sense. So we're gonna do something to these T cells to make them specifically fight my cancer. So if I'm going to spend literally hundreds of thousands to millions of dollars modifying these T cells to fight my cancer, the last thing I want is for those T cells to die off after a couple of months. And normally, T T cells do have a normal, have a sort of lifespan of a couple of months. And so I want these souped up T cells that are custom built to fight my cancer to live as long as possible. And so the first modification that we make to the T cells is to remove some of the surface proteins that normally limit the lifespan. So I'm going to spend a lot of effort reprogramming my T cells. I want to make sure they're going to live as long as possible. And one of the key discoveries behind being able to do this traces back to some basic science research done 30 years earlier by a group in France who were just curious about T cells and wanted to figure out what all of the surface proteins are on the T cells. And so these are just some of the surface proteins that various cells have, and these surface proteins allow cells to stick together. We'll be talking about a lot of these adhesions between cells in the next week or so. But these are ways that cells sort of identify each other, stick together, and sometimes figure out if this cell is getting old and needs to be replaced, or if this cell is still young and has some more work to do. These surface proteins allow cells to sort of find where they need to go, stay where they need to be, get removed, get turned, get modified, have a finite lifespan if that's what they need to do in your body. And so one of the first discoveries of this is that, it turns out that antibodies, which we talked about last time, are genetically similar to a lot of these surface proteins. And so IG, or immunoglobulin superfamily, refers to things that are related to antibodies. Immunoglobulin means antibodies. But these aren't actually, it kind of gets confusing because we're talking about the immune system, but it's actually not an antibody. It's just something that's related to an antibody that exists on the surface of the cell and helps to regulate its lifespan. And so one of the things that was discovered by this group, in addition to characterizing the protein itself, is and actually a lot of the data isn't shown because it gets a little bit complicated how it's collected and interpreted. But essentially, there's this surface protein called CTLA-4, and a couple other related surface proteins, and collectively they create a lifespan. They put a time limit on the lifetime of a T cell. And so one of the things that we want to do if we're going to reprogram our T cells is to take these off so that these special reprogrammed T cells that we are creating live as long as possible in the body. And another researcher about a decade after the French group first identified CTLA-4, James Allison, who's pictured here, showed that that if you block or remove CTLA-4, or if you block or remove other proteins, that can affect the lifespan of T cells and also affect their ability to target and alter cancer or fight cancer. Okay, so that's modification one. Essentially, we want to keep our T cells around as long as possible.
When you say block, do you mean block the production of the cell protein?
So in this case, they found another protein that would attach to this and cover it up in this experiment. But in the immunotherapy, what we're going to do is we're going to insert instructions into these T cells that say stop making these surface proteins, because we want you to live forever. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, sure.
So the CTLA-4, it tells it to stop making the surface proteins?
CTLA-4 is the surface protein, and it tells the rest of the body how old the T cell is and when it's time for the T cell to go away. And And we're going to interfere with that because we're going to make super T cells that are specially targeted to the cancer in this person's body. And we want to make sure that the rest of the body doesn't get rid of these T cells that we've spent several hundred thousand dollars creating to cure this person's cancer. Okay. So we're going to get rid of them. Yeah.
Okay. So because they're removed, they no longer send a signal that says,
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, exactly. Yep. Yeah, that's exactly right.
So another T cell comes and kills it?
Actually, no. It's mostly done in the spleen, a little bit in the liver, and some of the spleen and liver cells will. A lot of your blood passes through your spleen and liver. If your spleen's removed, then your liver has a little bit more work to do. But in your spleen and liver, older red blood cells and older white blood cells are identified and killed, and then their contents are recycled into your body or excreted as waste. Yeah. Okay, so that's modification number one. Modification number two comes back to this. So back here in step one, the first thing we did was we figured out what's unique about our cancer. And in particular, one of the things that we took note of when we figured out what's unique about this tumor is how do the surface proteins on this tumor differ from the surface proteins in the rest of the cells in your body? And so the second modification that we're going to make to the same batch of T cells is that we are going to program them to find and destroy any cells that it finds that have your tumor's specific surface proteins. So T cells, if you remember from last time, will learn to attack specific types of invaders, but we can also genetically program T cells to find a certain type of set of surface proteins and make that be its target. And so in step one, we figured out relatively cheaply for a few thousand dollars what are the unique surface features of your tumor cells. Now in step number two, we need to reprogram these T cells to be custom made to attack your tumor and not the rest of your body. And it turns out, for the reasons that we'll talk about a little bit later, that is the incredibly expensive part. But before we kind of talk about why that is the incredibly expensive part, I want to go into a little bit about why this was touted as such a breakthrough. And I guess before I do that, what questions more do people have about sort of the idea of the approach here, the reprogramming of T cells, making them target your cancer cells? Okay, and so this was attempted in 2012 on three patients, all of whom had terminal leukemia. And these three patients, I'm actually not very expert at looking at sort of biopsies of cancer, but before the immunotherapy was begun, there was in the bone marrow signatures of severe leukemia. These patients, given their current state at the time the trial began, were expected to only live for a few months. And so this was very much a sort of last-ditch attempt. And so here is from one patient, over the course of a month, his tumor, the evidence of tumor and leukemia goes away, and 6 months later, his bone marrow looks very healthy and exactly like bone marrow is supposed to look. I'm not going to expect you to identify what's different between these and how to tell whether something has leukemia or not, but just sort of to take the word from the researchers and reviewers on these papers that, in fact, and also the fact that these patients, these three people, are still alive now. So that they were sort of miraculously cured of their leukemia. One of the reasons leukemia has been used most for this is because Leukemia being already in the blood is a little bit easier for T cells to get at than like liver cancer or brain cancer. But there are now attempts being made to try and figure out ways to apply this to other types of cancer as well. But nonetheless, this is sort of the sort of miracle cure right here that these patients went through. And so then. The question is sort of like, well, why is this so expensive? And so I'm going to kind of move over here to co-opt a little bit more board about why this is so expensive. But you know, we spend a couple $1,000s figuring out what's unique about the T cells. What's unique about the cancer. We already have a system for. What we're going to do is we're going to make, essentially, what we're making is some custom HIV. And so we take an HIV. We take some HIV virus and remove its genome from it, so we're not going to get an active HIV infection or AIDS from this treatment. But we take the entire HIV genome out, and instead we still have in there the reverse transcriptase that converts whatever RNA we put in into DNA. We've still got the integrase that's going to insert that DNA that gets made into the T cell genome. But now, instead of reprogramming a T cell to be an HIV factory, we're going to put in instructions to not make this CTLA-4 protein anymore, and to instead make proteins that target your tumor. And so what this means is that we have to make a whole, because this HIV is not infectious, it's not going to spread. So we need to make a whole lot of copies of virus in a test tube that are customized to your tumor, and this same and for every patient, we're going to have to make a new custom HIV for every patient, because we've got to first figure out what's unique about their tumor, second of all, try and find protein sequences that are likely to help those T cells bind to that unique set of proteins on the surface of the tumor cells, and make as many of those possible binding interactions as possible, because we're most of the time kind of making educated guesses about what's going to work anyway. And so because we're making new custom HIV in large quantities for every patient, that becomes an incredibly expensive step, and one that that, as far as we can discern right now, is unlikely to become any less expensive as these therapies might become more and more prevalent. And this is the step that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars and extensive amounts of time and effort to make these custom HIV HIVs that are going to reprogram your T cells to fight your cancer. So what questions do people have about kind of like why this is expensive and why this is very sort of personalized to the person and their tumor? Yeah, sure.
This is
fine.
Is it the custom HIV cells that are then injected into the
patient? So then what we're going to do, so once we've got our custom HIV, we take bone marrow out of the patient, and mix the custom HIV and the bone marrow together in a test tube, allow the HIV to infect and reprogram a lot of the T cells and T cell progenitors in that test tube bone marrow. Then we take that test tube bone marrow and put it back into the patient, and then their body starts to produce these new T cells that target their cancer. Yeah, that's a good question, an important point to sort of be straight about. Yeah. Yeah, well, so this person, that's exactly what they did, and he was cured, and two others.
So they use the HIV for the
program? Yeah, because what they're doing is the HIV is to reprogram the T cells,
okay.
And then the T cells that get reprogrammed fight off the leukemia, which is a B cell overinfection. So it finds the bad B cell progenitors and kills them off.
The HIV
isn't to kill anything. HIV normally kills T cells, but here it's not killing the T cells, it's teaching the T cells how to find and kill whatever cancer cells are happen to be in your body.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, that's a very, very critical distinction. Yeah.
Is the reverse transcriptase RNA not part of the viral genome?
It is. So actually, we make a new viral genome that includes now reverse transcriptase and integrase, but not the rest of the HIV stuff that we don't want. Yeah.
So why would you not include it the instructions to amplify the virus?
Because then you're going to be killing a lot of T cells. Because the instructions to amplify the virus are essentially make a lot of virus and then blow yourself up.
Yeah,
but it ends up killing more T cells than are going to be saving anything. And so, yeah. And if you infect the stem cells that produce T cells, then those can persist for years and years in your body. And so that's sort of the approach, without creating this risk that you're going to create an active HIV infection. So we want to make sure there's absolutely no chance that we're going to create an active HIV infection in this person. And so that's why the HIV does not contain any instructions for making new HIV in it. Did you have a question, Kyla?
I did have a question. I was just wondering if there are other methods that exist that may be somewhat more efficient. They're just not like from the forefront. They're not as popular as well.
I don't know. I mean, so, you know, like customized chemotherapy is a lot more efficient. And it certainly has had some advances as well. It's a little bit tailored, but it's not quite as personally tailored because we don't have to make something that's very specific to exactly the target, surface proteins on there. And that is something that is customized chemotherapy is becoming the norm in cancer treatment. And it does help, but it hasn't had like the miracle cures of people on death's door like this that are coming back. In the intervening years since this, we'll talk about some of the sort of next few patients that came after these first three that were miraculously cured. But in the intervening years since this, there have been now dozens of patients that have been cured. Also, a few dozen that haven't been cured by this. So it's not a guaranteed, but it is 50% chance at survival when you're told that you have 3 months left to live is a chance that pretty much anybody's willing to take, especially considering that if you follow these patients, they remain cancer-free for years afterwards as we follow these patients. Yeah. Did that kind of help answer that question? Yeah. Other questions people have about that?
Once you've reinjected these modified T cells, do they replicate and make more
cells? Yeah, because you've actually infected the stem cells that are making T cells, and so those persist in the body. But in addition to that, the T cells themselves are coming out without these CTLA antigens on them, the CTLA surface proteins. And so the T cells, once they get made, will live for months rather than living for weeks in your body. And so that also enhances the number of T cells that are out there fighting your tumor and gives you sort of best chance.
So in general, if you want to do genetic modification on a human, you would target the stem cell that you can amplify?
I mean, it depends on what you're doing, but yeah, I mean, if you want something to last, especially in an area where cells do turn over with some frequency, then you want to get the stem cells that are in the process of developing into mature T cells or mature lung cells or whatever. Yeah. Yeah.
What's the relationship between the reverse transcription and the integrase?
So reverse transcriptase takes the RNA, which is what the genome is in normal HIV and this custom HIV, and converts it into DNA. And then integrase takes that DNA and puts it into the nucleus of the cell. And that's necessary in this case because we want, when these stem cells divide and make more stem cells, we want all of the more stem cells to have these new instructions in them as well. And so we want to get that into the genome. That's how, yeah, well, HIV normally puts its genetic material into your chromosomes. And so we're taking advantage of that to make sure that the changes persist across many generations of stem cells that are creating more T cells.
Could we somehow change the reverse transcription in order to change
No, HIV naturally, those two things are part of what HIV's normal sort of day job of infecting T cells is all about. It's taking the RNA that is its genetic material, converting it to DNA as soon as it gets into a T cell, and then taking that DNA and putting it into the middle of some chromosome somewhere to reprogram that T cell. And that's sort of the normal sort of routine for any retrovirus. Yeah, and so we're letting that part stay the same, but we're changing the instructions that are getting put in to be, instead of make more HIV, the instructions are now stop expressing these surface proteins and instead get yourself ready to fight off this cancer. And the get yourself ready to fight off this cancer means that the HIV has to be custom made to that patient and to the surface proteins on their tumor, which is the challenging and expensive part, to make a new custom retrovirus for every patient and make a lot of copies of this new custom retrovirus. Yeah. Other questions about that? So as you've seen, I occasionally pick up these XKCD comics, and one of them here sort of points out some of the ironies in this treatment. And while it's effective, there are some things that sort of on the face of it seem very odd. A couple of people talking about how this idea of immune therapy to attack cancer has actually been something that people have been thinking about for decades. And so what they did, just to sort of summarize it in sort of simplified terms, is they took the patient's T cells, patched their genes to attack the cancer. Usually that doesn't help, but here they also added code to get the T cells to live longer and replicate more extensively and persist in the body. This works, sometimes can have some side effects, although mostly it's actually quite effective, especially considering how bad a state these people are in at the beginning. But one of the things that is sort of ironic about this is that HIV is something that we normally think of as like the thing to avoid, and for good reason. And yet it's sort of odd to say, okay, so leukemia is blood cells reproducing out of control. What we're going to do is modify some of your blood cells so they reproduce out of control. And in the process, by the way, we use some HIV to make the modifications. And it's sort of okay, is that really the right way to do this? But it turns out to actually be, yes, that is actually kind of the right way to do this. And that is quite, that turns out to be, has been quite effective for some patients. So like I said, out of the first three patients that this was tried on, there were dramatic improvements. These patients were all expected to live for just a few months. And now all three are still alive and still appear to be cancer free. The next three that they attempted this on, the next batch of three patients that they attempted this on, showed no signs of recovery whatsoever. In the intervening few years since then, like I said, it's been tried on dozens of patients, successful for a little more than half, but not successful for others, meaning that the tumors don't recede, the patients still die at about the same time that they were expected to die, given their prognosis before they began the immunotherapy. So not only is this exceedingly expensive, very difficult, and very personalized, but sometimes we just don't know how to properly reprogram these T cells to correctly target this cancer. And that is something that probably will improve as this becomes, and things like this become more and more common, because it's a sort of very brutal trial and error process that is going on. And so one of the other researchers on this, David Porter, points out that there are dozens of examples of drugs that look great in the first handful of patients and then don't pan out. Cancer immunotherapy is becoming more and more, looking more and more like it's going to be a good long-term solution, but the expense is an issue, and there's still a lot to learn about how to reprogram T cells to attack all of the different diversity of tumors that are out there. What questions do people have about any of that?
In a normal person with mm-hmm. cancer, is the reason the immune system does not attack the cancer initially because the cancer has the same surface proteins that your cells do?
In part, yes, but actually, like I said last time, your immune system is on the lookout for cancer and does try to find it, but if you're at end-stage leukemia or end-stage other, if you're in sort of like last stage of cancer for anything else, then one way or another, your cancer has evolved ways around your immune system. All of us have cells in our body that probably already have had a couple of mutations in the cell lineage in a couple of different proto-oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes. Um, but But our immune system catches it before it becomes cancerous. And this is something that actually happens fairly routinely in your body, that your immune system catches it. And then when one of those gets by your immune system, then that's when you start to have a cancer instead of sort of some early stage growth that is about to be destroyed by your body, by your immune system. So your immune system's always fighting cancer, and that's one of the reasons why we actually get fewer cancers than you would expect. If you just sit down with a pen and paper and think about how many cells you have, how many rounds of mitosis are happening in your body in a given day, how many mutations happen, how many spots there are, genes that are necessary for cell division, you would come to the conclusion that you're going to get a tumor every week. And that's actually kind of not wrong, it's just that your immune system every week finds it and kills it while it's still like two cells big. And then if you're unfortunate, then your immune system is unable to identify and kill it. And then that is one of the later, sort of like one of the stages of defense, along with all of the mutation protections and everything else that are built into cells. Yeah. There's an article I'll try to find called Why We Don't Get More Cancer, and it sort of talks about how you would sort of expect cancers to be fairly common. And so one other thing that was published along with the sort of miraculous results in terms of the patient's recovery is also just looking at the proliferation of these T cells. So they were the researchers were able to track in these patients the modified T cells and how long they persist as compared to other T cells that are unmodified that still your body's making for all of the other purposes that your body needs to make. And so immediately after infusion of these immediately after you get the bone marrow that's been modified put back into your body, reinfused into your body, in your blood, we start to see within a month or so a rapid increase in the number of modified T cells. And because of these modifications that have been made to help the T cells persist longer, for half a year afterwards, those modified T cells are still around. In further follow-up studies, even 3 years later, those modified T cells still remain in the blood. So the modifications of keeping these T cells active are quite successful. Normal T lymphocytes have a sort of standard life cycle, and we don't get rid of them. But if you follow individual clones and individual lymphocytes, essentially. If you follow individual lymphocytes, they will come on and die off within a few months. But these are persisting much longer, both in the bone, in the blood, and in the bone marrow. So we're sort of successful at that, and that's why the tumor is receding. Okay. Questions about that? Going to get to one. There's one more complication that we've got to work through about this whole system. But before we get to that, I want to make sure everyone's got a good understanding of everything we've done so far. Okay. So I imagine everybody here has at some point in their life had a fever or a flu or a cold or something. And you feel like crap, you've got some viral infection, and there's kind of nothing to do but just hang out in bed and let your body fight off the virus. And the virus is bad because whatever type of cell it is, if it's the flu, it might be infecting sort of respiratory mucus cells. If it's HIV, then that's very bad because it's infecting T cells, and that actually prevents your body from fighting it off in addition to all of the other problems. But you know, for a lot of viruses, like if you get the flu, it sucks. You can't get out of bed for a couple of weeks, maybe, if it's really bad, or at least a couple of days. You got a fever, you feel like crap. But aside from some of the symptoms, the vast majority of the symptoms of the flu aren't because of the flu, they're because of your body's response to the flu. And so one other thing that we didn't talk about last time when we talked about the immune system is that the immune system, when it becomes active, then it's going to release a sort of hormone that goes into your blood called cytokines, a set of hormones called cytokines. And these cytokines trigger the production of mucus to try and protect your body from getting further infected and flush out your mucus membranes. If you develop viral pneumonia, which can kill you, you can be drowning in your own secretions that are a result of excess cytokines being produced. And so actually with any immune response, there are chemical cytokines that get released by the various immune cells. And what these do is then sort of two things. Number one is they can create a response such as fever, mucus secretion, etc. Number two is that cytokines will activate other immune cells. But there's a risk that you run with cytokines. And this is what will, if somebody dies from a flu infection, what kills them is this sort of out of control cytokine situation. And so what happens is, so your immune system releases cytokines, which creates a sort of response in your body and activates more immune cells. But then these more immune cells get active, and so they release cytokines. And so then that will trigger more fever, more mucus secretions, and more immune cells to get active. And so they release cytokines. And then that triggers more fever, more mucus secretion. It can cause excessive clotting of the blood, which can lead to heart attacks. It can cause various types of shock to happen in your body. It can damage your lungs. It can cause a lot of cells to die. It can cause your intestines to fail. It can cause you to drown in your own secretions. And so these cytokines can feed on themselves. When you die from a viral infection, with the exception of something like HIV, where it's usually actually secondary infections because your immune system has been so compromised it kills you, a lot of times if people die of the flu, they're actually not dying of the flu. They're dying of the cytokines and the response that their body's making to in an attempt to fight off the flu. And so by being a positive feedback system, it can create a lot of problems. And you can get, so fever is something that your body uses to prevent invaders from continuing to grow. The idea behind a fever sort of amounts to a fever. So, my cells are designed to work at 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 37 degrees Celsius. And if they get too hot, then my cells are going to stop working quite as effectively, which is not great, but I'm big, I can handle it, but a virus or a bacteria that's infected a small number of my cells, that small number of cells might not make it through the fever, but then the rest of me will. And so it's sort of a way to, you actually intentionally weaken your body as a way to weaken the invaders that are in your body as well. Plus it serves sort of the added benefit of making you feel like crap, which doesn't sound like a benefit, but it keeps you still and resting so that you're in, because the immune system consumes a lot of energy. And so your energy can be devoted to the immune system and you're not going out and running marathons while you've got an active flu infection, which is going to take up a lot of energy that your immune system needs to fight the infection. So, cytokines form an important response, but they have the risk of running out of control. And there are a dozen or so different cytokines that exist in your body and can be released. These cytokines have various names, none of which are very critically important. And some of them sort of promote fever. Others of them promote inflammation. Others of them promote sort of different kinds of immune responses. So the immune system's active and it's releasing cytokines. And in these first few patients that were published in 2011, the researchers were aware that there's this risk that they're running on top of everything else, on top of the risk that they might not reprogram the T cells properly, on top of the risk that their reprogrammed T cells might not survive very long in the patient's body, and on top of the risk that these T cells might not actually target the cancer correctly. There's another risk, which is they're turning up the person's immune system. And that is almost by necessity going to cause a spike in cytokines. And so this is the chart for one patient looking at one of their cytokines. This is that same one, and then a couple other cytokines. And so what they noticed in these patients for which these treatments were successful, as expected, there was a spike about a week or two after the infusion of the new T cells, of the new bone marrow into the patient's body, because the immune system had gotten ramped up. But fortunately for these patients, there are natural systems in everyone's body to prevent cytokine storm, and those natural systems function properly so that these patients' cytokine levels didn't get out of control, and within a couple more months return back to normal, which is exactly what they'd hoped to see. They were aware of the risk and checking for the potential of out of control cytokine release going on in these patients. What questions do people have about that?
So in the case of a regular flu, if you're at that time when you're having a cytokine storm, it might actually be better to just take an immunosuppressant and deal with whatever effects the flu has for you, which I assume.
Yeah. So in a normal flu for a healthy person, you won't get cytokine storm. Cytokine storm, by definition, is when things get out of control. So your body has cytokines, but there are also negative feedback mechanisms to keep the cytokines from feeding on themselves too much. And so cytokine storm is something that you'd be in the hospital if it happened to you. In a normal case of a flu, you don't have that. But you know, Tylenol and Advil and Benadryl and basically a large fraction of the over-the-counter medications that are available are immunosuppressants. Advil and Tylenol and Benadryl suppressing the allergic part of the immune system, but collectively they are drugs designed to suppress cytokines and turn down your immune system. And so, you know, if you've got a test coming up and you get the flu the night before, you take a bunch of Tylenol or NyQuil or whatever, shut down your immune system. Maybe the flu gets a little bit worse because you shut down but you can get through the exam and then go back to feeling like crap the next day. So that's sort of the trade-off that you make. So we take routinely when we get sick immunosuppressants to keep ourselves going. You know, for most healthy people, that's okay because your immune system's strong enough that it can fight off a flu infection even with some immunosuppressants around. And the immunosuppressants carry the benefit that you're able to keep doing things that you may need to do in your sort of life at that point.
Right, that makes sense. So actually, most of the crap that you take when you're sick doesn't really kill the thing other than antibiotics.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. A lot of the stuff that you're taking is stuff to slow down your body from fighting it, which is sort of counterintuitive and sounds counterproductive, but you know, important if there are things that you need to do in your life. So what other questions do people have about that? I mentioned a minute ago that back here, the first three patients worked really well. The next three patients, their cancers didn't recede. The seventh patient on which this was tried was a girl who was 6 years old at the time. She had end-stage leukemia. I actually always get choked up when I talk about this story because I think about my own kids who are now 6 and 7 or 5 and 6 or whatever. Same-ish age. What happened was, for her, the treatment was itself sort of successful. Her cancer began to recede away. But in her case, unlike the first six that they tried this on, where it had mixed six, where three were successful in the cancer, three weren't, but on all of them, the immunoresponse sort of had a normal like on and off, like it's supposed to. In this girl, her body went into cytokine storm. She was on a ventilator for a couple of weeks in an intensive care unit. And then there was a night where the researcher sent an email to the provost of University of Pennsylvania, where this was being carried out. He was going to say that, you know, this is, she's going to die. There's nothing left to do. And so that was kind of what they thought the story was. And so, you know, what had been happening in her body is she was dying from the cytokine storm. And sort of as a like sort of palliative effort, one of the nurses just gave her a strong dose of an anti of a medication that's normally used for arthritis that shuts down some of the autoimmune response in arthritis, and gave such a high dose that it seemed a little bit crazy, but it turned out that saved her, and so this is her a couple of years ago, 8 years old. Now she's 11, cancer-free. And so anyway, sorry, I get a little choked up more than usual about that. But it's pretty amazing to think of, you know, the roller coaster of this. So in terms of like things to be aware of, there's a lot of material that I've thrown at you about this. The idea of the customization for cancer, what HIV normally does, and then the reprogramming of T cells, the custom HIV, and then also the potential cytokine response that it's associated with. And so those are all kind of the core points to be thinking about as you're thinking through and reviewing this material. So what questions do people have about any of that? Okay, so we're down to only about 3 minutes left, so rather than moving on into the different compartments of the cell, we'll just pick up with that next week. So that's everything that you need for the quiz that I'm going to hand out on Monday that'll be due on Tuesday. Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock, I'll be in my office for office hours. If anybody has any questions about any of the material and they want to review after they've looked at it over the weekend, on your way out, if you haven't already done so on your way in, please give Emily your exam reflections and pick up the homework on DNA replication that is going to be due on Monday. And then, like I said, Monday I'll give you the quiz. It'll be due Tuesday. Emily will also be in the library Monday evening from 5 to 6 down on the fourth floor if anyone has questions about any of that.